this is set to be one of the most important broadcasts we've ever done. Things are moving a lot faster than even I thought they could. Barack Obama came out last night, gave a speech, and if you really listen to what he said, he called for the invasion of Libya. And he says that behind the scenes for the last 3 days, and that was last night, that an international response is being prepared. The Wall Street Journal, the BBC, are reporting that Gaddafi, of course, has nerve gas, mustard gas, Scud missiles. He's bought a lot of high-tech weapons from the British, particularly. There's a big scandal going on right now where the British Prime Minister, of course, traveled with a bunch of arm dealers 2 days ago to Egypt to immediately start selling more weapons to them. The British have been the biggest sellers to Gaddafi while Gaddafi supposedly blew up one of their airliners. It's just crazy. So here we are. Here we are on the verge of yet another country being invaded. And that's exactly what I've been saying for a month. As Egypt falls, as they prepare to bring down Saudi Arabia, as the globals prepare to bring down Yemen and Bahrain and even Jordan and all these other nations, in many of them, it's going to get violent. There's reports that the West Bank is going to flare up. Missiles are being fired again. Lebanon's going to flare up. And the situation in Libya is off the charts hardcore right now. Off the charts hardcore. I don't have to explain that to you. You know that. We're going to be playing when we come back from break Obama's speech, his statement last night. We're going to be analyzing that. We're going to be covering this and other important news for the next 2 hours. But, ladies and gentlemen, we do not want to get involved in Tripoli, in the situation there in Libya. Gaddafi is armed to the teeth. Let those people sort it out. But we're already involved because the globalists that run our country are now on record. It was even the Washington Post yesterday that the opposition group in Libya launching this is being financed out of Washington. And we've had articles covering all that at Infowars.com and PrisonPlanet.com. Does that mean the people don't have a legitimate reason to not want to be under a creepy dictator? No, I mean, I'm all for them having a revolution if they want to have it. But the people running our nation 5 weeks ago sent El Baradei in to overthrow their puppet, Hosni Mubarak. Now that's happened. Now the Muslim Brotherhood's taken over. Gaddafi. We're now hearing, oh, Al-Qaeda's there. He's now running Al-Qaeda. First, Saddam runs Al-Qaeda. Got to be invaded WMDs. Then it's in Pakistan. Before that, the Al-Qaeda was in Afghanistan. Now Al-Qaeda is in Somalia. Then Al-Qaeda is here, there, everywhere. It's like a set piece on a chessboard. They just move the Al-Qaeda chess piece wherever they want to be able to strike, and that allows them to move their pieces into the area. I mean, this is extremely elementary, what we're dealing with here. It's the great game, divide and conquer. But for the public who's not aware of it, they're completely blind. The general public has no idea. All they know is Gaddafi, bad man. Gaddafi is reportedly, we don't know if any of this is true, British intel has been, of course, previously ran Libya through their puppet king before Gaddafi came to power in the late 60s. And they were the ones that said he'd fled to Venezuela. And that was done to destabilize it further and embolden the opposition. And now they're saying he's been strafing and bombing people with helicopters and jets. Maybe true. Certainly not a good thing to do. But what happens with the 1,000-plus drones in Afghanistan and Pakistan and other areas killing whole wedding parties of hundreds of people supposedly to kill one bad guy? Oh, that's okay to bomb or strafe weddings and markets. But, oh, when Gaddafi does it, it's so horrible. It's the hypocrisy, ladies and gentlemen. We'll be right back. Charlie Sheen's coming up, too. Well, in case you missed it last night, President Obama gave a speech. Here's the CNN headline. Obama condemns Libyan violence, calls for international response. He said in the days previous to that that they were already behind the scenes preparing the international UN/NATO response, and that will be military. That will be Marines from all of the NATO countries. That will be armed forces, Air Force, going into Libya with a guy who for 40-plus years has been stockpiling giant amounts of nerve gas, mustard gas, Scud missiles, you name it. Egypt's in striking distance. Israel's in striking distance. Italy, I mean, this is out of control. This is crisis creation. And what have we been saying that the globalists are going to do to basically destabilize the world as a smokescreen for the global depression that they've engineered? They're going to start a war. They have a playbook. They do this over and over and over and over and over again. We've been saying we don't know where it's going to start, but probably the Middle East, a destabilization campaign that is going to then spread all over the region. And it is on record in the Washington Post. It is on record in the Associated Press. They even admit that the main Libyan opposition leaders that triggered all of this are run out of Washington. So, yeah, they've got to respond to the humanitarian disaster they have triggered. Again, the people of Libya, great, rebel, 1776, whatever. Self-determination, I'm all for it, against a brutal dictator. But why would the globalists trigger this at this time? Not because they want to bring freedom to that region. They want another war to pump hundreds of billions of dollars in, another invasion, another overthrow to ensure that the dominoes keep falling. And then they're going to put extremists into power. They're going to have groups all around. And again, by extremist, I'm using the term that the establishment uses, so the general public knows what I'm talking about. Anybody that doesn't want to be occupied. They're going to put those people in so they can then have a war with them. And you heard it here from Webster Tarpley, historian. You heard it here from yours truly, from Paul Watson, from Aaron Dykes. How do you think the tiny British Empire dominated more than half of the major countries in the world just 70 years ago? They wrote manuals, handbooks on how they play one country against another, then take over that next country, then play that country off against the next. Or they'd fund rebels in an area as a pretext to come in or to scare the neighboring country to then join with the British. This is how this works. This is how a little bitty country was able to do it. And the French did it. The Spanish did it. The Portuguese did it as well. Nobody has ever done it as good as the British. The British openly. In 1900, 1905, 19, you know, all those years leading up to 1914, the start of World War I, openly said, Germany's rising. They're taking over the world via their advanced technologies in chemistry, in all the sciences. You know, it was called, you know, the danger of the rising Germany. And Britain openly said, we've got to start a war with them now before it's too late or our global empire is going to fail. We've got to team up with America to do it. But Americans don't want to be involved, so British intelligence was publicly sent to the U.S. to buy off politicians. The Germans ran, you know, news headlines, bought out full-page ads saying, don't sail in the Lusitania. It's a auxiliary ship carrying munitions from the U.S. It's a military ship. It's flagged military. We're going to sink it. And they told them for 2 months. And then when they did sink it, they said, oh, my gosh, remember the Lusitania. We've got to have war. But before that, the British, through the Black Hand, this is all mainline history, engineered the shooting of Franz Ferdinand, the Archduke of the Austrian-Hungarian Empire. And it was on. And, of course, the Germans were imperialist and wanted global domination as well. It's not that they were good and the British were good or the British were bad and the Germans were bad. It's just what they were. It's empire. It's how humans operate. It's what the Chinese have tried to do thousands of years ago and regionally. It's what the Japanese have tried over and over again. It's what the Arabs have tried with each other. It's what happened in Mesoamerica with different, the more ancient, the Toltecs and others, but then the Mayan culture developing, and out of that, the Aztecs and others, and whoever was the most cunning, warlike, manipulative ended up taking over. This is what empires do. It's like a tropism. What's a tropism? A plant, you plant the seed, it gets sunlight, heat, water, nutrients, it sprouts, it grows, it turns towards the sun. It doesn't have a brain. It's a wild thing that's pre-programmed. And humans do the same thing over and over again. That's why it said, those that don't know history are doomed to repeat it. That's why history is the key to the present and the future. History, 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 history. And they want the public to be mindless, to be one-dimensional. And to say, Alex, are you saying Hosni Mubarak's good? Are you saying Muammar Gaddafi's good? No. I'm pointing out that Gaddafi 8 years ago made a peace deal with the globalist. Look what happened to him. That just allowed infiltration. He did try to develop his country. Compared to some of the people over there, his socialism actually did hand out some of the goodies. Because when you have an absolute dictator, he doesn't care about a big government class that's feeding on people. It was pretty streamlined, but very oppressive. But he did develop Libya. He did disperse a lot of the money. Still a horrible guy. But compared to the globalists, not one 100th as cunning and Muammar Gaddafi found out they were putting AIDS viruses in the vaccines through UN programs, and that was confirmed. He wouldn't allow them to come in with abortion. These were his people, his cattle. And it kind of like, I've known some farmers and ranchers that love their prized cows so much, they won't even butcher them. And they end up just, having hundreds and hundreds and then have to finally sell some off because, I've known farmers and ranchers that go out and pet their cows. My grandfather was that way. He had certain cows he'd had for 10, 15 years that were his friends, and he just couldn't sell them. But side issue. The point is, it's kind of like that. Kind of like my grandpa liked his cows. That's what you got with Muammar Gaddafi. Okay? No, you're not going to poison my cows. Okay, the globalists are like, there are too many cows. Yes, get rid of some. China signed on 35 years ago, 37 years ago, to the UN population reduction program. Now, I'm going to go out to break with this clip of Obama last night. I'm going to come back and really try to walk through all of this, but this is on record triggered by the same banks that have hijacked our country and hijacked Europe. I don't even want to say it's our government doing it, but it's on record now. The articles are posted at Infowars.com and PrisonPlanet.com. Mainstream news bragging, America. No, not America, the globalists, but they say America. Yes, it's run out of D.C., the opposition group they're going to put in and bring freedom to that region. But then meanwhile, the Muslim Brotherhood and all them are saying death to Gaddafi. They're going to set up a totally Islamic state, and then the whole cycle will start over again. And see, now, oh my gosh, Gaddafi is strafing his own people. We've got to invade. Meanwhile, over 1,000 drones every day on record. The Pentagon has said they can kill 200 people if they're getting one person they want, and that's good collateral damage, that is acceptable. But then Gaddafi has, in many cases, armed CIA-backed globalist intelligence operatives who know how to drive tanks, who know how to use weapon systems, trained attacking military bases, and he comes in and strafes them. If you can even believe that. The media has lied so much saying that Gaddafi, fled 4 days ago when he hadn't. So let's go ahead and play part of the clip of Obama. We'll come back and play the rest. Here it is. Here is Obama.
Good afternoon, everybody. Secretary Clinton and I just concluded a meeting that focused on the ongoing situation in Libya. Over the last few days, my national security team has been working around the clock to monitor the situation there and to coordinate with our international partners about a way forward. First, we are doing everything we can to protect American citizens. That is my highest priority. In Libya, we've urged our people to leave the country, and the State Department is assisting those in need of support. Meanwhile, I think all Americans should give thanks to the heroic work that's being done by our Foreign Service officers and the men and women serving in our embassies and consulates around the world. They represent the very best of our country and its values. Now, throughout this period of unrest and upheaval across the region, the United States has maintained a set of core principles which guide our approach. These principles apply to the situation in Libya. As I said last week, we strongly condemn the use of violence in Libya. The American people extend our deepest condolences to the families and loved ones of all who've been killed and injured. The suffering and bloodshed is outrageous, and it is unacceptable. So are threats and orders to shoot peaceful protesters and further punish the people of Libya. These actions violate international norms and every standard of common decency. This violence must stop.